everyone. I wanted to go over some of the most common lab reports that we use for PCOS patients and go over some of the lab testing that I've done in the last few years to really understand what's going on with my PCOS. Hopefully this video will give you a better understanding of, you know, what we're looking for when we're doing lab work and how it can help us to really identify what is going on. So in terms of B12, you want your number to be around 500. This is a good number for myself. This year has been a little bit lower for me, but this is a previous year and it looks pretty good. Iron, this is ferritin, is your storage form of iron. So you want it to be around, you know, 50, 60, 70. If you're starting to lose hair, you know, you want this number to really be at an 80. So really looking into that with your naturopath, it is important. And I just want to make sure that, you know, that this video is just informational. Please note that this does not allow you to give yourself a diagnosis of PCOS. It's just information to really just make you better understand what we're looking for in lab reports. If you have any questions, please consult your naturopathic doctor or family physician. Okay, so let's keep going. So this is glucose. Oops, sorry about that. This is fasting glucose, and so you want this number, see the reference range is between 3.6 and 6. So you want it to be on the lower end of the reference range. For example, if you're even at like a 5, 5.1, you're on the high end of the reference range, so you want to be careful too about your glucose. HbA1c or hemoglobin A1c is a marker of how well you're able to process glucose over the last 3 months, and it's a marker for diabetes. So anything greater than 5.5% puts you at risk for diabetes, and anything greater than 6 to 6.4 puts you in the category of pre-diabetic. Anything greater than 6.5 means diabetes. So this is a good marker just to know exactly what's going on and how well you're able to process glucose. And so, you know, glucose goes hand in hand with insulin, because as we eat something that has glucose, insulin is secreted from the pancreas and helps us to get glucose into the cell for energy. So, you know, it's really good to see what your fasting insulin is like. Mine is at a 42 here, but if it was really high, then we would know that there's insulin resistance going on. And so we want to kind of treat that with naturopathic medicine or even medication. But there's another test called the insulin glucose challenge test, and that can further help you understand about insulin sensitivity. This is my thyroid panel. So, you know, a full thyroid panel will include TSH, free T4, and free T3. TSH is secreted from the brain. It tells the thyroid to release free T4 and free T3. And so in terms of, you know, fertility purposes, you want your TSH to be less than 2. So at a 1.46, I'm looking pretty good. For free T4, you want it to be around 14 or higher. And so at this number, I could use a little bit of work, but nothing really treatable. And then your free T3, you want it to be around 4. 4.6 is a great number. But, you know, I often don't see this in practice. So, like, making sure you have nutrients that support the thyroid and no deficiencies of that is really important as well. Okay. So these are hormones from our pituitary gland that help tell us some more information of how the pituitary is really, you know, working to send the signals to the ovaries to create hormones. So follicle-stimulating hormone stimulates the ovaries to produce estrogen, and luteinizing hormone stimulates the ovaries to produce testosterone, and it is mostly helpful in ovulation. So typically these markers should be done around cycle day 3. So if the first day of your period is cycle day 1, you go on the third day of your cycle, and you want these numbers to be at a 1-to-1 ratio. Typically you want FSH to a little to be a little bit higher than LH. And sometimes in PCOS patients, this number can be significantly higher at a 2-to-1 or 3-to-1 ratio. And that can also say that there is PCOS. Prolactin is another just marker. You just want to make sure that this is low. Low, and if it's high, it can either mean that there's some stress involved, and or it can also mean that that there's potentially a pituitary adenoma. So this means that the pituitary gland can be affected, and so that's something to look into. But if your number is low, there's nothing really to be concerned about. HCG is basically checking if you're pregnant. Oftentimes, if you haven't gotten a period in a long time, they will check your beta HCG just to make sure you aren't pregnant. And then estradiol, which is your estrogen, tested at cycle day 3, should be around 150 or in the hundreds or 100. You don't want it to be greater than 300. They'll prevent you from doing a cycle in the fertility clinic at that point. But at 100, you know, there could be some work to do for me in terms of my estradiol on cycle day 3. Okay. Then progesterone, this was also tested on cycle day 3, so you want it to be low. You also want to test your progesterone about 7 days after ovulation to see if you ovulated. Numbers greater than 30 can suggest ovulation or a robust ovulation, so it's good to also check that too. Androstenedione is a marker of testosterone, so it's a precursor to testosterone. So if this is elevated, it can mean that you have high testosterone. So just making sure that this is as low as possible is key. And this was tested on cycle day 3 as well. And then I'm going to skip over 17-hydroxyprogesterone, but DHEAS is also a marker of testosterone that comes from our adrenal glands. And, you know, when this is elevated, we know that we really want to work on our stress hormone or our stress in general. And so, you know, I'm creeping up there at a 7.6. So stress is something that I should be also focusing on and making sure I'm taking that into account. And then testosterone and free testosterone. So testosterone, you want it to be less than 1.8. And then free testosterone, you want it to be as low as possible in PCOS patients. Oftentimes, these numbers can be normal on blood work, but still the patient is exhibiting symptoms of high testosterone, like acne or hair growth or hair loss. So you just want to keep that in mind. Even though the lab work says that it's not elevated, it still can be elevated. And so this is just one or two markers of testosterone, but there's a lot more. Okay, and then sex hormone binding globulin. This is a protein that binds to hormones and sequesters them. So you want this number to be at a good number, like high enough so that it like binds to all that testosterone that you're building. And so testosterone doesn't cause issues for you. Oftentimes, if sex hormone binding globulin is high, then insulin will be a little bit lower. But if sex hormone binding globulin is low, sometimes testosterone can be high, or sorry, insulin can be high, and then testosterone can also become an issue then as well, because as sex hormone binding globulin is low, there's not enough of it to bind up all that testosterone that your body might be producing. So it's important to look at this marker as well. Sometimes, not all the time, we can kind of get a sense through insulin, but it's a good marker just to check to see how things are going. C-reactive protein is a marker of inflammation, and so you want this to be less than 6. So mine is pretty low, so that's good. There's not a lot of inflammation. And then also for zinc, when we have high testosterone, there can be a deficiency in zinc, and zinc actually helps to just modulate the production of testosterone. So it's important to take sometimes, but really checking your levels and seeing. And so for me, I'm kind of sitting in the middle of the reference range, a little bit on the upper end, so that's good. But yeah, just keeping that one in mind and looking at it is a good thing to look at. And then beta-carotene, I learned a little bit about this recently, that when it's high, it can actually inhibit follicular genesis, which is the ability to make follicles. And so the reason being is that beta-carotene needs to be converted into vitamin A, and vitamin A is actually used for follicular genesis. So if your beta-carotene that you're eating from your veggies, like sweet potatoes, butternut squash, like all the carrots, all the orange, yellow type of veggies, then it can actually, if it's high, it can actually be a marker of potentially not converting to vitamin A, which is what we need for follicular genesis. So there could be a vitamin A deficiency when these levels are high. So that's just something to keep in mind. And this comes from genetics. And so maybe even doing a genetic report would be good too. Okay. And then you can't really see this one. But basically, it's called dihydrotestosterone. Sorry about that. Let me see if I can change this. There we go. So this is dihydrotestosterone. And basically, when testosterone gets created, it can convert into this very potent form of testosterone called dihydrotestosterone. And as you can see, I'm a premenopause adult, and so my number is significantly high. This was tested last year, so we'll see what it looks like this year. So that means that I'm making, even though my testosterone was normal, I may be creating too much of the strong testosterone called dihydrotestosterone. So this is something to definitely keep in mind, because testosterone can prevent, you know, or cause a lot of the symptoms in PCOS. So it's definitely something to keep in mind. I hope this was helpful. This is just a tool for information. Doesn't provide a diagnosis, but kind of gives you an idea of what tests that I'm looking out for when I'm assessing a PCOS patient.